Tēnā koutou katoa. Welcome to Te Ao with Moana. Last year, I started working on a story about a frightening medical event, aneurysms. Now, whenever I've raised the term in a conversation, someone inevitably recalls a friend or relative who has suffered or died from one. Young, old, women, men too. It seems that aneurysms sneak up on people and wahine Māori are impacted at twice the rate of Pākehā women. The questions are, what are the risk factors, what are the warning signs, and can we come back from them?
She had a massive headache, what they call a thunderclap headache, as we found out later, and was displaying signs of incredible pain, incredible headaches, and not really with it.
I just was on the ferry going home one night on a Friday night, and I started getting this thumping headache, which is not normal for me. You know, got home, had some painkillers, they didn't really touch the sides of it, didn't really go away.
Cerebral or brain aneurysm. They call it a thunderclap for a very good reason, because it comes like a bolt from the blue. It's unbelievably painful, and Māori women are more susceptible than most.
So an aneurysm is a weakening of the blood vessel. It causes an out pocket to occur, and over time, as pressure builds up for whatever reason, that weakening then becomes bigger and balloons out, and for some people it can actually burst.
Why do some people get them?
So we know some people are more at risk for having aneurysms because it might run in their family, so there is probably some familial link there. We know that there are also risk factors for aneurysms, including having high blood pressure over a longer time, which the pressure pushes against the blood vessel, makes it weaker. Smoking seems to be another risk factor for it as well. And then for some people, we just don't know. And it's just there and we don't know it until they start to get symptoms.
Those symptoms include severe headaches, seizures, passing out, nausea and vomiting, double and blurred vision. Sophie Hakaraya works in film and television. She's lucky. Her aneurysm burst, but she got to the hospital in the nick of time.
Well, I would say I was pretty healthy, but looking back, I was probably running on fumes, as we all are sort of around, you know, with the COVID and working, and I'd just started on a drama series, which had to be sort of stopped and started a few times and things like that. So I was under a lot of stress. And so I thought I was really healthy, but actually, in fact, I was probably not as healthy as I thought.
Sophie was on her way home from another hectic day on a film set when the first warning sign struck. It was the mother of all headaches. And then...
So it was a Tuesday and I was at home and I was on my computer sort of madly trying to reschedule things and for the shoots, and then realised I had a production Zoom meeting with the entire production crew, so I thought I'd better shower. Better get some clothes on, you know, because, you know, Zoom. And I went and had a quick shower, jumped out of the shower, drying myself off, and suddenly got really dizzy and started thinking I was going to pass out, thinking, whoa, what's going on? And sort of fell to my hands and knees, and then this pain, this is what I now know is a thunderclap headache, just came on, and it was just so intense. And my first thought was, I'm having an aneurysm.
She recognised the symptoms because a friend had an aneurysm only months before. Sophie managed to call a mate who was preparing to phone a chopper to airlift her from Waiheke Island.
It was weird though because it actually started to die off, the pain started to subside, and then I felt a bit like an idiot because he was going, we'll get the chopper, we'll get the chopper, we'll get you out of here, you know, and I was, whoa, wait, I think I'm coming right. Shit, I feel a bit stupid now. But then that was a Tuesday, but I didn't feel like it had completely gone. I had a really stiff neck, so I thought my neck was out, which is why I got this headache. But I know now that that's one of the symptoms, is a stiff neck.
5 days later, Sophie was joking with a mate about being a drama queen, thinking she'd had an aneurysm. They clinked glasses, and that's the last thing Sophie can remember.
He said, I just started grimacing and saying, it's coming back. Oh my God, it's back. And then he went to get me a glass of water, and when he got back, I was in a fetal position on his couch, just go, you know, like going, and then I just started retching, and it just, yeah.
We know that there are people who are walking you know, walking around quite fine and probably do have aneurysms, and it's not until they pass away and they might have an autopsy for another reason that we can actually see that they've had one. There are some people who have aneurysms and they might present to their doctor with headaches and go on to have a scan of their head, and we can see it that way, and then they can go on to have surgical intervention to try and manage that. But unfortunately for some people, because we're not aware that they've got the aneurysm, and if they burst, it can be catastrophic, and they can be left with lifelong disability from a stroke, and for many, they can die.
Sophie underwent emergency surgery. Her aneurysm was coiled to stop the flow of blood into it. She was out after 2 weeks in hospital, but the impact was lingering.
And my eyesight was just shot. I was constantly cross-eyed, which is great. I saw double, triple of everything. I couldn't handle, I couldn't read anything really. It was quite hard. But I do lose my words and I do forget things, you know, and I have a thing which I call a glitch with walking and things like that. I was really aware of, is that the ground? Yes, that's the ground. Is that the ground?
Oh, there's spatial.
There's a curb,
yeah,
coming up.
Yeah.
Okay, so we can do this.
Yeah,
you know,
you have to really concentrate.
So that kind of takes away a lot of confidence within myself and how to, you know, doing things. So, you know, putting a glass down somewhere, you know, I'm 99% sure that that's going to happen. Occasionally, I will just take it, you know, like take it for granted that that's happening, and then it doesn't quite get there in the end, and that's the glitch.
Were you offered tools or services to help you kind of cope with that?
No, no, not at all. No, I left the hospital and there was no mention of rehab, no mention of anything like that, no mention of, I don't know why, but possibly because I hadn't had any noticeable, you know, sort of real deficits. And I was pretty keen to get out of there, and I think they were pretty keen to get rid of me.
The aneurysms form on the undersurface of the brain generally, in the big arteries that supply blood to the brain, as opposed to the little tiny arteries that go into the brain.
I'm with Dr. Alan Barber, Ngāti Porou Whakatoa here, Professor of Clinical Neurology at the University of Auckland and Clinical Lead for Stroke at Auckland City Hospital. Dr. Barber says the prognosis for cerebral aneurysm is generally not good.
A third of people will be left with some residual problems, so either thinking problems, concentration, memory, mood problems, language problems, so difficult understanding what people are saying or expressing yourself, or weakness in their arms or legs or face. And so that's about a third of people, and about a third of people make a good recovery. So it's not a great prognosis.
In Taranaki, and against the odds, ultramarathoner Lisa Tamati explored different treatment options for her mum, Isabel, a stroke and aneurysm survivor. The results are remarkable. That's after the break. From Sophie's experience, we're going to hear a very different and inspiring story of how another woman has come back from the seemingly impossible. I'm looking at your necklace, Isabel, all the black pearls, they're very beautiful. Where did you get that from?
Lisa made it.
Well, they look beautiful and you look very glamorous.
Thank you.
How are you feeling?
Not really glamorous, but I'm doing fine.
You've done amazing. Do you understand how amazing you've done?
Yes, I do, because I didn't expect it, you know. At the beginning, I thought, oh, this is it. Lisa's spent all those months researching everything and finding the right way to attack it. And that's what we've done. I just have to do what I'm told.
How's that though?
Oh, that's hard work.
Do you want to fire your coach sometimes? Do you want to fire her?
Definitely.
Yeah, but you've kept her on.
I have. Yes. I have. There's no choice.
She's got your back though, hasn't she?
Oh, she has. Yeah. Every inch of the way.
Many of us know Lisa Tamati as an incredible ultramarathon athlete. And by ultramarathons, I mean 250 kilometres in this sort of heat, 217 kilometres through Death Valley, the Indian Himalayas, tackling the Sahara. But Lisa's biggest challenge came in 2016. That's when her 74-year-old mum, Isabel, was struck by an aneurysm and stroke at home in Taranaki.
Can you describe to me what it was like when you were having your aneurysm? Do you remember any of that?
Don't remember any of it.
I remember my dad coming to me and thinking, well, we better start planning for the funeral.
Lisa wrote a book capturing the shock and disbelief of a family who could barely process what had just happened to Isabel.
I mean, she was overweight, she had high blood pressure, she had, you know, issues with thyroid. Other than that, she was a healthy, you know, she was off to the gym, she was at aquarobics, you know, she was working full-time still.
And how old was she?
She was 74, so she was doing pretty well.
I'd like to introduce you to my whānau. This is, we've got Mum and Dad, Cyril and Isabel, and my two brothers, Dawson and Mitchell. And we're going to talk a little bit today about the importance of sport and health and fitness within the family realm.
Children need to be busy and they need to be striving to learn new things.
Yeah.
They need to be disciplined and learn to practice to be good at things. Things that you need for life, aren't they?
A former teacher, Isabel had gone from being active and engaged to this.
Go.
Lisa told us that basically the doctors had written you off.
Yeah.
So, you know.
I have had a miraculous recovery, and mostly because my children have all stuck with the plan. They've all taken on the fact that Lisa's the boss and everything has to be run past her.
So after that 3 weeks when she'd stabilised and came out of that, she was basically not much over a vegetative state, a little bit, but not much. Massive brain damage, so she had no control of any of her bodily functions, no idea who she was or that I was her daughter, no memories, you know, and it was really heartbreaking to look into my mum's eyes and realise that she doesn't have a clue who I am or what I am, and that she couldn't understand anything. And at the beginning, she couldn't even sit, like she was just flopped over to the side. She didn't know what was straight. Her right side had also had a stroke, so she was paralysed on the right side. She had spasticity. she couldn't speak. She couldn't, you know, a couple of words she had.
The doctor's advice was to put Isabel into care, but Lisa was having none of that.
I knew my mum, she would not want me to put her into an institution. I knew that she would be totally against it. And then I believed too that nobody could care for her like I could care for her and my family.
As with her sports, Lisa simply refused to give up. She drew on all her training and experience and discipline as an athlete and poured it into her mother, got her into a routine.
My training as an ultramarathon runner really prepared me in a number of ways for this journey. Not from that I had any medical background, but I knew how to fight. I knew how to grind out rehabilitation training. When you're motivated by love, then, you know, you'll pull out all the stops. I made a promise to her when she was in a coma that I would do whatever it took to get her back or die trying. I'd done a lot of racing at altitude. I'd had altitude sickness before. I've had a hypoxic brain concussion from not having enough oxygen. I've had infections in my body from lack of oxygen. I was seeing these signs in my mum. I was seeing like her mouth had infections in it. I was seeing signs that she wasn't getting enough oxygen. So I started to, you know, put two and two together in my head and thought, I think she has sleep apnea.
Lisa began an exhaustive search to see whether her theory about oxygen held up.
I had studied something called hyperbaric oxygen therapy and realised that this was her biggest opportunity. It's not used in New Zealand for brain injury, but it is overseas.
She landed on this, a special hyperbaric oxygen chamber. The patient lies inside and breathes in pure oxygen, much more than is possible in normal air pressure. Divers use it for decompression sickness. Lisa and Isabel are convinced it's helping stimulate cell growth and healing, but it hasn't come cheap.
I mortgaged the house, I bought a hyperbaric chamber, I installed it in my house, all of which was easier said than done. And I started to put her through sessions. We would do 5 days a week for an hour and a half a day.
Lisa wouldn't let up, which was demanding on Isabel as well.
So what sort of things did you do?
Exercising, lots of activities around strength building.
So I had her doing a routine of about 8 hours a day. And the doctor said to me, look, I understand that you're an athlete and you know how to push through boundaries and you can, you know, as an athlete, but you can't do that with neural fatigue. She will be tired and that's it. But I would train her in one way, and when she tired, then I would do some breathing exercises or have her close her eyes for 5 minutes or give her a rest for 20 minutes, and then I would approach something else. So our whole day was sort of broken up into rest, work, rest, work.
The most important thing has been to hang in there and to leave her to guide the ship, if you like.
And the ship is looking pretty good.
Yes, it is, isn't it?
Pure oxygen, regular exercise, and a super strict dietary regime.
It's all healthy food.
Is it?
Yeah.
Healthy.
Really healthy.
Yeah. Do you sneak some stuff in sometimes?
Occasionally. I haven't known to do that.
Yes.
It's been intense, an incredible journey that's defied much of the conventional wisdom around rehabilitation.
I'm a true believer that no matter what age you are, you need goals. You need to be striving. I think the worst thing that we can do for our elderly population is to make them comfortable. I think comfortable in our world, you know, is making things easy, but it's actually helping us decline quicker.
Lisa recalls when her number one client spoke for the first time. It was to tell her daughter off, and she's still doing that.
Mummy's learning to run. Go, go, mummy, go, go, go.
Even a couple of weeks ago, I was in the gym and I was putting pressure on her back and she was doing squats and I was, you know, holding her down, and she comes up and she's fighting up against me and she goes, I just want to punch you in the face.
Have you run into other people who've had aneurysms and strokes? Have you met other people?
No, I've completely avoided other people that have been through the same thing.
Why is that?
I just don't want to get emotionally involved.
Do you get frustrated by things that you can't do now?
I don't really bash my head against the wall and say I can't do that anymore. It's more what can I do, yeah, rather than what I can't do. You just have to be a bit patient with me because I can mess up.
Haven't seen a sign of that?
No.
Yeah.
Lisa can't say for sure what exactly has made the difference or if the rehab program she devised will work for anyone else. But for Isabel, the results speak for themselves.
I haven't got a recipe for you to say, if your mum has an aneurysm, do this, this, and this, and this, and you'll be good. Because the brain is very complex. That person's brain damage may be different than that person's, but there are some commonalities and some things that we can try, and these are pretty low-risk interventions. You know, things like hyperbarics, things like supplementation and the right nutrition and the right exercise programs and the right sleep protocols and meditation and things that have got a lot of evidence behind them.
Isabel's devoted husband, Cyril, supported his wife's recovery. In 2020, the artist, firefighter, and musician died from an aortic aneurysm. Isabel now lives with her daughter.
Yeah. This is her pills list here. And so there's 20, what is she on, 28 things, I think, she has to have.
You know, your coach, your live-in coach and daughter, she'd be one of your besties now, wouldn't she?
Yeah.
She's done remarkable, hasn't she?
She has. And she knows how to stick with it and keep on pushing, which for me is so important, you know.
I spent thousands and thousands of hours retraining her brain from the, basically from being like a toddler right through to being an adult.
It would be easy for me just to shrug my shoulders and set things aside and think I can't do that, but I can and I will.
You sound relentless.
I am relentless.
Kā rawe. Isabel has since been diagnosed with an aggressive form of cancer. She's undergoing treatment, still going to the gym, and supported by Lisa, who's wrapped an even more intense program around her mother. So far, so good. Isabel told me anyway that she wouldn't dare go and die because that would just rock the boat. As for Sophie, 6 months after her surgery, a scan picked up a second aneurysm. She was back on the operating table to have that one clipped. And good news, Sophie is enjoying life back on the film sets. Last week in Tāmaki Makaurau, what a special send-off for Ngāti Whātua Rangatira, Joe Hawke. So much aroha, so much respect.
I te mate rānei, i te ora rānei, kai te wāwāhi taha a Joe Hawke, no reira he hoki ngā kāinga, he hoki ngā one one.
Ko takaparawhau kiko kia takaparawhau one one. Ah, kā tau, ah, kā hono ki reira.
Nō te matenga o Joe Hawke, kua kōrero tia tēnei wāhi, hei oki oki ngā mōna.
When we celebrate the 25th of May, that's where we go. That's where we go at daybreak.
Ai, te waiata reo rōreka nei a te tangata nei, ka haere tonu te whawhai mō Ngāti Whātua.
Leaders from across the political spectrum paid their respects. National leader Christopher Luxon posted this tribute on Facebook in te reo Māori. You can see how thoughtful and respectful it was. But did it strike a raw nerve with some Pākehā anyway? Like Daisy, who said, maybe if that was in English, I would understand what you were saying. John, time to vote for ACT. Les, that Luxon had just lost his vote. Colleen reacted by saying, English would be good, then we would all understand what you're on about. Māori language is okay for those that want to learn it, but if you check history, they didn't even have an alphabet, so how could they have a language? And Arthur, well, speak English for F's sake, so sick of Māori stuff. Certainly triggered people, but in contrast, how about this? Aroha Gray said, thank you, Christopher Luxon, for acknowledging my uncle, my friend and my hero. Your words in both English and Māori are well suited for such a rangatira as Uncle Joe. Clear. Well done, Christopher Luxon, for a fitting tribute to Joe Hawke in te reo. Really saddened that so many of these comments do not embrace all the cultures of our land. Joe Hawke was a wonderful rangatira and we loved hearing the stories at Orake the other day. Now, in other news, we're pretty thrilled to be among the finalists in a bunch of categories for this year's Voyager Media Awards. There are some heavy hitters in there, so it's a big deal for our whole team and for Kāta Māori. Here's a little highlight. Do you know that you have a bit of a fierce reputation?
No, I don't.
Your reo and your standing and your mana is just a little bit intimidating to learners.
Well, you know.
Like we get a bit nervous.
You don't have to be nervous.
Well, we just feel it.
But you don't have to, you see.
You have never been arrested before. You have never been in a cell block before.
No.
So at this point, what was running through your head?
Jail.
I was just horrible anyway, because I just couldn't stop crying.
It was things like, if he comes back to our marae, we're going to take run him over. And, he better not come near us, we're going to kill him. I actually had to sit down with my whānau, my wife, and just to reassess, is it worth continuing?
What do you think your bubba thinks about you now? What do you want her to think about her dad?
I just want her to be proud of me and just to know that, you know, everything that I do is for them. Yeah.
Decarceration is impossible without a conversation around decolonisation. What do you think about that?
Well, I think that's dead right. But that's the conversation we're actually having. There's no doubt about that in my mind. We are having a decolonisation conversation. We've been having it for a generation, and it's gathering momentum now.
That was such a fun year. Don't forget you can watch all our stories online. Next week we have an exclusive with the lead singer of this banger. Yes, Peter Garrett joins me in the hot seat from his studio in Sydney. Hey, Corner.